I want to pick up with Acts today, and I want to talk about something that maybe a little different. I don't know that we've ever talked about this before, so this will be different. I want to talk about the idea of connectors. There are people in this world who are connectors. You know what I mean by that? They know lots of people, and they don't just know lots of people, but they love to connect other people. Right? They love to make those connections. There was a game years ago, 6 Degrees of Kevin Bacon. Do you remember this game? Right? It's based on an old theory of 6 Degrees of Separation that everybody in this world is connected far beyond where we think we are, and that you actually can connect to anybody else on the planet with just 6 steps. You know somebody who knows somebody else who knows somebody else who knows somebody else who knows somebody else who knows that person. And it's a fascinating experiment. And the idea is that we are so interconnected that it only takes 6 hops to get to anybody. As I think about this, I think about people that I have known who love to connect other people. Right? One of my mentors, a guy named John Maxwell, he loves to say this when he's talking to new people. He loves to say, "Hey, who do you know that I should know? Who do you know that I should know?" What's he doing? He's connecting, right? He's saying, "Hey, I want to know who you know. And I think you know somebody who could help me get better at what I do, and I want to grow in that." And so he's all the time asking that question when he meets new people. Who do you know that I should know? I love it when I meet somebody who is a connector because they are all about adding value, not just to the people that they already know, but to new people by connecting them. Are you that person? Are you a connector? Is that how God has wired you? Or is that an intentional step you have taken to connect other people, to help make their lives better and stronger in some way? You know, the idea of a connector is really rooted in Scripture. This idea that I'm going to look out for you, I'm going to think about you, I'm going to stand up for you. I'm gonna speak up for you to somebody else. And I love this idea, and this is what we're gonna talk about today. This idea that I'm gonna stand up for, I'm going to speak up for you. Somebody else that may not speak up for themselves. We're gonna look today in Acts. We're gonna be in chapter 9. So if you want to power on or turn in your Bible to Acts chapter 9, we're gonna start in verse 19 where we left off last time. And we're only going to cover about a dozen verses today because I think that's a good stopping point with what I want to focus on. We looked last week, you might remember if you were here, we looked last week at a guy named Saul who was breathing out threats against the church, was absolutely opposed to everything these followers of Jesus stood for, and was persecuting them, and actually went to the religious leaders of the day and said, "I want your authority to go and persecute people in Damascus," which was a major commercial hub. On the way, he meets Jesus, and everything changes. Everything changed in his world that day. And we looked last week how God sent a man named Ananias into his life at that point, who not only met an immediate need for healing, because Paul had been blinded when he met Jesus, but also stood up for him and immediately started to call him Brother Saul, even though this is the guy who'd been arresting and even killing followers of Jesus. But he welcomed him. He put his arm around him and he began to connect him. Such a powerful story. So this is where we left off last time, where Saul is in a very different place than he's ever been. He thought he was doing the right thing. He thought he was following God with all of his heart, but he missed it. He missed it when God did something new. So he's still in Damascus, and for some days he was with the disciples of Jesus there. What do you think they're talking about? Jesus. All of a sudden, Saul is like, "Well, I don't, I'm not sure of my footing." He's been knocked off of his horse, so to speak, and now he's not sure where exactly to plant his feet. but he's starting to get his bearings. And so he spends some time with other disciples who I believe are pouring into him, speaking into him, encouraging him, teaching him. Saul had an incredible understanding of the Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible. He had a mastery of that. But now he's looking at it just a little bit different. Now he's looking at it through the lens of God has fulfilled his promises, that he has sent the one that he promised, the Messiah, the one named Jesus. For some days, he was with the disciples at Damascus, and immediately he proclaimed Jesus in the synagogues, saying, "He is the Son of God." This is the core of what will be Saul's teaching for the rest of his life. That Jesus is the Messiah. He is the Son of God. And where does he go to proclaim this message? The place he is more comfortable than anywhere else. In the synagogue. He goes there because this is where the people of God have gathered, right? He goes there because they understand the Hebrew Scriptures. And he is going to tell them, hey, guess what? It's been fulfilled. All who heard him were amazed and said, "Is not this the man who made havoc in Jerusalem of those who called upon this name? Has he not come here for this purpose to bring them bound before the chief priests?" They had heard about Saul. They knew why he came to Damascus. They knew what he was all about. They're like, I hear what you're saying, but I know what you've done. I hear what you're saying, but I know why you're here. And there's very much this arm's length that they want to keep between them and this guy. So we understand this, right? This is human nature. But Saul increased all the more in strength and confounded the Jews who lived in Damascus by proving that Jesus was the Christ, that is the Messiah. Now, this word proving is interesting in Greek. It's the idea of putting a puzzle together. That's the picture. So think about Saul, who has memorized the entirety of the Hebrew Bible, what we call the Old Testament. He's memorized all of it. Now he's got all these pieces, and he's starting to put these pieces together in such a way that he is showing, hey, guess what? You know how God said he was going to send a Messiah? Look. And they had never seen this particular puzzle before. And he shows them that Jesus is that one. And he fulfills every promise. And he fulfills every prophecy. And who else could do that? And this is what Saul was doing. And he's doing this first in the synagogue. When many days had passed, the Jews plotted to kill him. Is that surprising to us? No. Why? Because, and we've talked about this before, if you don't know how to argue against somebody's point, you begin to attack the person. It's called an ad hominem, right? If I can't defeat you in your argument, I'm just going to attack you now, personally. And that's what they do. Many days had passed. That's interesting. Luke uses that phrase. Saul will tell us later in one of his letters that this was about 3 years. Right? And for 3 years, he was in Damascus and in the environs and actually traveled to a place called Arabia, right? And Arabia is south of Syria where Damascus was. It's a Nabataean kingdom. And the king at this time was a guy named Aretas IV. The capital of this area you've probably heard of. And some of you've been there. Some of you've been there with me. It's a place called Petra. Paul spent 3 years in Damascus and in Arabia. We're going to talk about why that is in a minute, but understand that's what's going on. He's not just going into the synagogues and then like 3 days later, they're like, you're dead. This is several years that are passing here. When many days have passed, the Jews plotted to kill him, but their plot became known to Saul. They were watching the gates day and night in order to kill him. But his disciples took him by night and led him down through an opening in the wall, lowering him in a basket. Does this feel dignified to anybody in the room? Because I promise you, It has less dignity than even you might think. They're trying to kill him. So some of his friends are like, okay, well, I live on the wall. There's a window. We can lower you in a basket at night. There's no dignity here. This is not exciting. When he had come to Jerusalem, he attempted to join the disciples there. He leaves Damascus at night, goes to Jerusalem. He tries to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him, for they did not believe that he was a disciple. Now, why would they think that? Because of everything he'd said and done. They didn't buy it. No chance. And here's the kicker. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostle and declared to them how on the road he had seen the Lord who spoke to him and how at Damascus he had preached boldly in the name of Jesus. So he went in and out among them at Jerusalem, preaching boldly in the name of the Lord. And he spoke and disputed against the Hellenists, but they were seeking to kill him. And when the brothers learned this, they brought him down to Caesarea and sent him off to Tarsus. Tarsus is where he's from. That's his hometown, right? So everywhere Paul goes so far, he's going to Damascus. He's going to Arabia, which we will learn later in Acts. While he was in Arabia, he stirred up a hornet's nest, and those people wanted to kill him. Goes back to Damascus. They lower him out of a window in a basket, and he goes to Jerusalem and stirs up a hornet's nest. And so what do they do? Why don't you go back home for a bit? Don't you need some time off? Maybe you just need to go back, for just a season. And they send him to Tarsus from Caesarea. Caesarea is a Roman port city. It's in Israel, but there were more Gentiles there than Jews. It was built up. It's a beautiful place. This was the seat of the Roman government, the Roman occupying government there. And in Caesarea, there's a port. They sent him off and said, hey, why don't you head home for a while? And so they did. And I love what Luke says next. So the church throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria had peace. Because Paul's gone. Because everywhere he went, there's not exactly peace. And was being built up and walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Spirit, it multiplied. That's where I want to stop. Saul's primary message, everywhere he went, every time he opened his mouth in a synagogue, was that he had become convinced that Jesus is the Son of God, the Messiah. Here's a guy who could not have been more adamantly opposed to this idea. And all of a sudden, everything changed because he met Jesus. He goes into the synagogues and he is all about proving that Jesus is the Messiah. He's putting the puzzle pieces of the Old Testament together, all of these hundreds of prophecies, everything that has pointed to the Messiah, the one who would come, that God would send, who would change and put things right that had gone wrong. Now he's come. And Jesus would proclaim, the kingdom of God is here. And this is what Paul is proclaiming. This is what Paul is teaching. He's pointing the people to this truth. But understand that it didn't happen in just a moment. The change in Saul did, no doubt. But his preparation to do what we're going to see him do in the rest of Acts did not happen in 10 minutes. It involved time in Arabia. 3 years, he says. 3 years that he's bouncing between Damascus and the Nabataean area, this Arabian. What's he doing in Arabia? If you've ever been there, it's gorgeous. It's barren. And there's not a lot to look at. I mean, you go into Petra, that's neat. I mean, they lived in homes and buildings that are carved into the rock. It's gorgeous. No power tools. This is by hand. It's going to take a minute. He's in a place that is barren, that is hot. There's not a ton of water. What's he doing there? Why does he go there? Well, I love how Peter Barnes puts, or William Barclay puts this. He says, into Saul's life had come a shattering change. And for a time, he had to be alone with God. Before him stretched a different life. And he needed two things: guidance for a way that was totally strange, and strength for an almost overwhelming task that had been given to him. And he went to God for both. You ever have a time when you just need to get alone with God? You just need to hear from God because you don't understand, you don't get it. This is different. This is, I mean, Saul thought he was on the right path. He thought he had it figured out. And then he met Jesus, and Jesus said, "Why are you persecuting me?" And all of a sudden, Saul gets it, that these followers of Jesus have it right, and he had it wrong. And now he's got to figure this out and reframe everything in his world. And I think that's what he went to Arabia to do. I think that's where he began to reframe everything and think more deeply about everything he'd ever learned. If this is true, if this was Jesus that he met, and he had no doubt that it was, then that means that the rest of his life is going to look very, very different. And so it did. When Saul comes out of Arabia, he goes to Jerusalem, and he starts trying to fit in with the disciples. He starts trying to build community with them, but they're scared to death of him, just like the disciples in Damascus have been. They're scared to death of him because they don't trust him. They don't believe that this is legitimate. They think he's a mole. He's a mole. He's a spy. He's just sent to infiltrate so he can figure out who all's involved, and then he can round them all up. Makes sense. I think he goes to Arabia to prepare when he begins to understand this is not going to be as easy as maybe he thought at first. He goes back to Damascus. He's chased a bit out of Arabia. We'll read more about that later. Aretas is not a fan. He goes to Damascus. They're trying to kill him. He goes to Jerusalem. He stirs everything up there. He was on the other side of this not that long ago. He was the persecutor. But now, the persecutor is now persecuted. Everywhere he goes, Damascus, Arabia, Damascus, Jerusalem, wherever he goes, they're trying to kill him. Why? Because he's saying something they don't want to hear. I love N.T. Wright. He's one of my favorite New Testament scholars. He wrote this. He said, "How did you start your great missionary career, Saul?" "Well, I was let down through the wall in a basket and I ran away." This is part of his story. Like, this is how you started. This is how the great Saul, who later will be known as Paul, this is how he started. Not exactly auspicious. What's he surrounded by? He's surrounded by disbelief and fear. Nobody believes him, right? Everywhere he goes, people are like, "Yeah, okay, whatever. You stay over there and do you. I'm not going to be with you." They don't believe him and they're afraid of him. And this is where he is. And what do you do in that situation? Well, I'll tell you what one guy did. Barnabas took a risk on Saul. And he was the only one there who did that at that moment. He took a risk on Saul there in Jerusalem. And he began to tell the other disciples what Saul had experienced and what he had been doing after he met Jesus. But how did he know that? He had to listen to Saul first. He had to listen and believe. And then when he did, he stood up for him. He took a risk for him. And he's the second person we've seen in the last 2 weeks who took a risk on Saul. Peter Barnes says it this way. He says, twice in the early stages of Saul's faith, it was other people who played important roles in helping him find his place in the church. Ananias first, and then Barnabas. Can you imagine what would have happened if Ananias and Barnabas had both said no? No chance. Not taking a risk on this guy. He's not worth it. We don't trust him. We don't believe him. No way, no how. What if they had not taken a risk on Saul? We likely wouldn't know his name. And we wouldn't have two-thirds of what we call the New Testament. Because that's what Saul, later known as Paul, is going to write. Barnabas is what William Larkin calls a bridge person, a connector, to use my parlance. He's a bridge person. He's going to be a bridge from one person to another, from one person to a group. He's going to stand up and speak out and stand for. And I love that. Here's a question that I've got for you and I've got for me and I've got for all of us, really. Who are we taking a risk on? Who in our world needs us to take a risk on them? That's not easy. Barnabas stuck his neck way out. But because he did, it made a tremendous difference, not just in Saul's life, but in millions of others. Who can you and I be a bridge person for? Who can we be a connector between? You know, this idea of standing up for and speaking up for other people is something that we see throughout the scriptures in so many places. I love Barnabas because we've already seen Barnabas, you might remember earlier in the book of Acts. Barnabas was called the son of encouragement. That's what his name was translated as, son of encouragement. Apparently, that characterized who he was. He was an encourager of other people, and we see him doing that here with Saul. And so that leads me to my last question, which is, who can you be a son or a daughter of encouragement for in your world? The guy who started Chick-fil-A, a guy named Truett Cathy, used to chuckle and say, you want to know how to know if somebody needs encouragement? If they're breathing. That's how you know. Spot on. Who can we be a son or a daughter of encouragement for? Who can we speak up for that other people are not? I was reading an article this week. Of course, I'm sure many of you have been following what's going on in Israel and Gaza and that whole situation. And I encouraged you last week that we really need to be praying for our friends there. Got a number of friends in Israel and trying to see how they're doing and check on them. And it's just a horrific situation. There's a guy that I follow. I've been reading his stuff for probably a decade or more now. His name is Dr. Russell Moore. He's now the managing editor, I believe, at Christianity Today, right? The publication that Billy Graham started way back in the day. And I wanted to read you just a piece of something that he wrote that really made me think about Barnabas and what I'm talking about today with regard to what we're talking about with Israel. He coins a term that I have never heard but is now part of my vocabulary, both-sidism. Both-sidism. It's a good word. It's made up, but I love it. Both-sidism about Hamas is a moral failure. He says, sometimes certain moments in history reveal in minutes what was concealed for decades. And sometimes those moments of revelation come with hearing oneself say the words, "Yeah, but," or "But what about?" The aftermath of the Hamas terrorist attack on Israel is not one of those times. In this case, saying who is to blame and who is not is not factually or morally difficult at all. Both sidism is an imprecise label. There are several senses in which an appeal to both sides of the reality here are completely right. For one, both sides are human beings created in the image of God. Amen. We ought to care about the lives and deaths of Israelis and of Palestinians in the West Bank, in Gaza, or anywhere else. An Israeli life is of no more value in the eyes of God than a Palestinian life, and vice versa. Both sides also refers rightly to who is harmed by this atrocity and the inevitable war to follow. Hamas is killing and destroying the futures of both Israelis and of Palestinians. That's one of the reasons we shouldn't think of this as a war between Israel and the Palestinians, but exactly as Israel defined it, a war on Hamas in response to a vicious and unprecedented attack. Hamas targeted innocent civilians. Hamas butchered young people dancing at a music festival. Hamas murdered elderly people and toddlers and babies, reportedly in the most sadistic ways imaginable. If you have not seen this, it's horrifying. In a kibbutz in Israel, and it's a unique way of living communally. In a kibbutz, typically the babies are kept in a nursery. It's a large room where the babies are cared for. And it seems that some of these Hamas people went into the nursery and decapitated the babies. There is no contextualization needed to condemn that. To recognize Israelis and innocent Palestinians as victims here, with Hamas as the evildoer. And as President Biden put it, full stop. This is the quickest way to recognize if you have outsourced your conscience to some ideology or sect. If your first response to seeing obvious immorality or injustice is some version of, "Well, obviously that's bad and no one supports it, but do you know what the victims did?" Then you are in a morally dangerous place. That way lies hackery. I don't know if, like me, you have seen a whole lot of that whataboutism, both sides-ism. I've been seeing and hearing that. I understand. Every person's created in the image of God. You've heard me say that 100,000 times. And if you stick around, you'll hear me say it 100,000 more. Because I believe it. You've never locked eyes with someone who doesn't matter to your Heavenly Father. But we do not morally equivocate. What is right is right, and what is wrong is wrong. And to go in to a nursery and to commit that kind of atrocity is always wrong. And there is no justification. And there is no way to spin that or say, "Well, but..." Sorry. Doesn't work like that. Who stands and speaks and says this is wrong or this is right? I'll tell you who. It's the church. That's what we get to do. We get to stand and we get to say this is right and this is wrong. Not because we've decided right and wrong, because God has. God has decided this. He has determined this. And while it has been encouraging to see a number of world leaders and governments come and stand and say this is wrong and be unequivocal about it, and I've been very glad to see that, including our own administration, it doesn't really matter if they do or not, truth be told, because that's our job. That's the church's job. we stand and we speak for others, particularly those with no voice. We stand and we speak for those who are butchered in a nursery. And we say, this is wrong. And there is no way to justify that. We stand and we speak and we say, this is wrong. You do not paraglide in and start raping and killing people indiscriminately who are at a music festival. You don't do that. There's no justification for that. Are there grievances? Of course. But that's not the way. I think about Barnabas and I think about what he did for Paul. What he did for Saul at this point. And I think what it took for him to stand and say, this is, y'all, we need to stop. We need to stop attacking this guy. We need to listen to what he has to say because God has done something in his life. He spoke up for him. And I believe that's what God calls each one of us to do in the church. To stand and to speak up. And to call right, right, and wrong, wrong. And sometimes I think we're afraid to do that. I think just like the people who were in the church in Damascus, the people who were in the church in Jerusalem, we have a little bit of disbelief and a little bit of fear, and we just stay silent. Aren't we glad Barnabas didn't do that? I think that's an example for us. I think it's an example for us of how important it is to stand up and to speak. When we see injustice, when we see what is wrong, we need to call it. And when we see what is right, we need to encourage it. That's what we get to do as the church. I think that's being Jesus' hands and feet in this world. I think that is being the people of God. So here's my challenge for you. I want you to think about Barnabas, and I want you to think about this in the context of where you are. Who can you be a son of encouragement or a daughter of encouragement for? Who can you speak up for? Who can you stand up for? How can you speak out for what is right and speak against what is wrong? Not living in fear. Fear of what other people might think or say. But instead say, no, what's right's right and what's wrong's wrong. And I'm not backing down on that. And I didn't decide what's right and wrong. You didn't. I didn't. God has done that. And we are his people, and we carry his message, and we carry his truth. And just like David led us in the song earlier, he is the way, and he is the truth, and he is the life, and no one comes to the Father except through Jesus. My challenge for you this week is I want you to look in your world, in your sphere of influence. I want you to look at where you can be a Barnabas. Look for those opportunities when you can speak out, when you can stand up and not cower. Will you do that? Will you do that? Let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, sometimes it's hard to speak up. Sometimes it's hard to stand up for someone else. We can get so wrapped around the axle around what other people will think or say. My prayer for us this week is that we would look in our spheres for places that we can be a Barnabas. We can be a son or a daughter of encouragement. A place where we can stand and speak for what is right, for those who are right, and speak against what is wrong, and not fall into the trap of equivocation, of trying to both sides it. May we be clear. May we encourage the right and speak against the wrong. And in so doing, bring your truth into this world. into our spheres. May we be unafraid like Barnabas was when he stood up for Saul, knowing he was sticking his neck out there. May we be just as courageous, just as bold. I pray this for each one of us in the name of Jesus. Amen.